All right, good morning, everybody. I had to run a few logistics a moment. Sorry I was a little bit late, but that's all right, okay? Today is Connect Sunday. This is something new for this year as we're coming out of COVID and things, and one of the keys to Connect Sunday is that first word, connect. We want you to connect to one another. We want you to connect to the ministries of the church. We just want you to connect with the Lord Jesus Christ better and better. And Connect Sundays are a bit special. We do special things. It's a little bit longer, and today will be no exception. But today we are privileged, very privileged, to have the Shaw Family Band with us, which Brother Ben will introduce in a little while. This group is, I've heard them warming up, and I've watched a little bit of YouTube on them. I have been really excited for the day when they would arrive here, and that day has finally arrived. So that's wonderful. I want us to begin by looking at the passage of Scripture in the bulletin from Psalm 95:1. And this psalm says, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation." All the way back, you know, this was written 3,000 years ago, basically. And there were people who believed, put their faith in the God who created them, and they were singing and shouting, and they were praising the Lord through music back then. Now, I don't think they had PA systems, and I don't think they had computer systems and all these kinds of things going on, but you know what? It doesn't matter what the instrumentation and things are. The main thing is that our hearts are praising the Lord through the music, and that's going to be the bulk of our worship today. It's going to be music. I'm not going to preach, and everyone said, amen. That's what I thought you would say right there. Not going to be preaching today, but we are going to be worshiping today. But before we get into the musical portion of our worship service today, we are also wanting to connect you to some various things that's been happening in the recent past. And we also want two young ladies to connect to our church through membership and sharing testimony through baptism this morning. So let's first consider those two young ladies who are going to be baptized this morning. We've got Abby Nelson, if you will stand up, and Melaine Waters. I don't know where they are. There's Melaine. You can't much more than see her popping up. And Abby is standing up. She's no taller than her daddy. Raise your hand, girls. There, now you might be able to see their hands. These two young girls have given their life to Jesus over the past few weeks, and they are going to give testimony to that through baptism at the end of a service. So I just wanted you to be aware of that. Now, I was explaining to them that what they're doing is they are giving testimony. Testimony. Both of them, being young, I was like, "Do you know what a testimony is?" You know what their answer was? "No, I don't know what a testimony is." See, that's a church word we often use, but then I say, but it's more than a church word. It's also a court word. A witness gives testimony in a court, and they began to understand that. A witness, things that they have seen and experienced in the past, they share with people in the present, and that's what a testimony is, right? Well, we should be giving testimony all the time. Baptism is just that first testimony we should be giving, but we should be giving testimony with our words all the time as followers of Christ. Now, I want to give a testimony this morning about the mission trip that you sent Brother Randy Roper and myself on, along with three gentlemen from Mossy Grove Baptist Church. We went down to Belize, where we have partnered, and in Belize, we had basically two primary objectives. First of all, we were going to help Mossy Grove finish up what they call the tabernacle down in Belize at San Isidro, the village of San Isidro. Now, a tabernacle isn't what we think about. A tabernacle is what I call a glorified picnic shelter, all right? I put some pictures up on the screen and up on Facebook while we were down there, and people started commenting about the church building. That's not what we were working on. That had been finished by Mossy Grove and some of our teams that have gone down there 2 years ago. The tabernacle is what we're standing under here. This is the team, five of us, plus Brother Blaine McFarland, our Southern Baptist of Belize missionary down there in Belize. So we were putting the roof on this tabernacle. If you look to me, it's to the right, yeah. You see that sort of teal green concrete box right there? That is a baptistry, an outdoor baptistry. Putting it under the tabernacle means that they can do baptisms rain or shine. And in rainy season, that happens a lot. That is probably the first baptistry in all of Southern Belize ever. And now the church that we've been helping construct in Bella Vista, they came over and looked at that and took pictures. And on Sunday, we went over to Bella Vista just to see how things were going. And they have just about completed their second baptistry in all of Southern Belize. And that's because we and churches in Tennessee and in Texas and Florida have been working down in the south part of Belize. So there's the team that went. I want to show you the next picture. There is the tabernacle, as they call it. Now you understand why I call it a glorified picnic shelter. And the baptistry is toward the back corner. And you can, I picked this one because you can see the church building that was constructed 2 years ago. And this is just a beautiful plot of land there. So we finished that in about 3 days. And then the other part of the project, you'll see with the next photo, then Brother Randy Roper, myself, and Jim Disney, the pastor at Mossy Grove, we got to spend 3 days with about 15 pastors, and we were teaching them things about family devotion, and we've committed to them that we will give them a 3-year cycle. So we are continuing to prepare these devotions that we give to them in 3-year cycles. As we prepared the first 13 weeks that we taught them, Brother Jim Disney and I said, well, why are we doing this just for our churches down in Belize? Why don't we do it for our own churches? And you probably haven't noticed. I mentioned it, but I know how it is when I mention things. It goes in one ear and out the other with a lot of you, right? But at the bottom back of your bulletin, you will see this week, this is week number 5, a question, an answer, and 5 scripture references. What we taught the pastors to teach their families is each night have your parents read the question, have the kids begin to speak the answer back every night, 5 nights, and then read the next scripture passage and talk about how it relates to the answer and the question. When I was younger with children, younger children, I used to think I had to have a big fancy devotion. You don't. Just a scripture, a conversation, and a prayer. And that's what we're providing for you, which is also what you all, by sending us down there, is providing for 15 churches in Southern Belize. So I just wanted you to be aware of what was going on. I think that, did I have another photo? Yeah. We took up a collection, if you remember, and our church sent $5,000 to, this is Indian Creek. Now, one of our teams several years ago did Vacation Bible School in Indian Creek, so those members will know where we're talking about. This was the building. Someone else gave the money for the concrete and the blocks, which the men of the church have already completed, but they didn't have enough money left over for the roof. So we sent down money, $5,000 U.S., to put a roof on. Now, if you think inflation's bad here, when Brother Blaine bought the wood for the rafters, it cost 11,000 Belize, which is 5,500 U.S. We thought 5,000 U.S. would cover the whole thing, but wood cost has gone up astronomically there as well. But from what I understand, there is a gentleman at Mossy Grove who gave the rest where they could go ahead and buy the metal to go on top of it. So this building may now have a roof on it and Indian Creek Baptist Church worshiping in it. And it's because of us and Mossy Grove and another church out in Middle Tennessee. And one thing Brother Blaine says, and I just tell you this, he said the work that is continuing in Belize would not be able to continue if it wasn't for First Baptist Rockwood. Because we've been giving more money, more personnel than any other church, whether it's in Tennessee, Texas, or Florida. Now, there's other churches giving, but I want you to hear what Brother Blaine says. You all have been given more than anybody. And there's probably 600 to 800 Mayan Indians in Southern Belize who have facilities, whose pastors now have been trained, and it all began with Brother Mike Helton, just sort of the tip of the spear, and then First Baptist Rockwood and others coming together collectively and making these things happen. So I wanted to share that testimony with you. It's what I've seen and experienced, and you've been a major part of that. And I said, we got baptism. It's one testimony coming up at the end of service. I shared testimony about the Southern Baptist of Belize that you are a major part of. There's one more testimony I want to be given today. Miss Joni Daugherty, come on up here. Do you want Pete up here with you, or are you afraid he'll take over? Come on up so they can see you both. Now, they're relatively new members of our church, so I know a lot of you all probably don't know them. From Maryland, yes. Right? So they came. How long have you been members? 2 years? Roughly? Three? Yes. See, time flies when you're having fun.
I know.
There you go. Joni has a unique experience this year, and I wanted her to share that with you.
Testing, one, two.
We're good. So, Joni, do you want it on the mic? You want to hold it?
That's fine, because I have my mic.
Gotcha, gotcha. All right. Come on up here and
okay.
Share that testimony.
Okay. Boy, have I got a story for you guys. So I was a kidney donor for my sister-in-law on March 15th. Pete's sister, her name is Sandy. And the process of this donation was really pretty amazing to me. You know, with a crowd this big, I'm sure you know somebody who was a donor or know somebody who maybe was a recipient, maybe you were a recipient. But when we were up in Pennsylvania, by the way, we were there for a whole month being tested. Pete got tested. Unfortunately, he had to be taken out because they found out that he had he was prone to getting all four kinds of kidney stones. We didn't even know that there were four kinds. But so he was taken out right then. I, on the other hand, had passed all the tests right away. I only had to redo two, but I could redo those here. In any case, we're up in PA for the entire month. And I just wanted to kind of start with two Bible verses that had been ringing through my head this entire time. And hopefully by the time I'm finished, you'll be able to understand why this is going through my head. The first one is Psalm 139:14. And that says, I will give thanks to thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are thy works, and my soul knows it very well. And the other verse that was going through my head constantly was Isaiah 30:21. Now, this was God talking to the people of Zion, but it affected me. So this is, your ears will hear a word behind you. This is the way, walk in it, whenever you turn to the right or to the left. So when Pastor called us up in Pennsylvania, he said, you know, would you give your testimony? I said, sure, I can do that. But where do I begin? There's so much to tell. He said, just write down a couple of bullet points. So after we got off the phone, I grabbed my paper and my pen, which is right next to me. I started writing down, and Pete said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm writing down the bullet points. He said, already? I said, yeah. So I'm just going to show you real quick my bullet points. This is one page. This is another. This is another. Wait, I'm not done. And this is another. These are just bullet points. God has worked so amazingly this entire process. But I just wanted to, first of all, thank you guys so much for praying for us. We literally felt those prayers up in Pennsylvania. Never before have I felt prayer. I've felt prayer in the past, but this time I felt like I was wrapped in a blanket for lack of a better explanation. And I heard the Holy Spirit say, people are praying for you. And never before have I gotten that incredible message of people praying for me. So I want to thank you. And I want to thank you for the cards you sent. And I want to thank you for the cards you sent my sister-in-law, Sandy, up in Pennsylvania. It was so moving how you guys care and love and loved us through this whole process. And I want to thank you for that from the bottom of my heart. And Pete feels the same way, I know. And it just meant so much. I just wish I could explain that to you. But before I go into any of my story, I only wrote down four or five bullet points. So kind of to recap the whole thing, I need to take you back a couple of decades to my conversation with my dad. So a couple of decades ago, my family was visiting my parents, and we were just rocking in some glider rocking chairs, which he made. And so we were rocking, and he just stopped, and he looked at me, and he said, "Joni, why do you think God gave us two kidneys when we can function just fine with one? Do you think it's to extend the life of another person and give them more time to find Christ?" And so fast forward to a couple of months ago, Sandy called and said, "I'm on the donor transplant list." And Pete and I said, "All right, where do we sign up?" She said, "I'm not asking for anything. I just want you to know the status. I'm on the list now." She's been on dialysis for 4.5 years at that point. And her kidney functions were dead. They were gone. So she had been on dialysis for close to 5 years. By that point, all her organs were starting to get affected by the dialysis that she went to every other day for 4.5 years. So she called and said that. So we're like, okay, we're signing up for it. Fast forward a couple of conversations with her. We talked to her a lot. And we were talking to her about us going through the testing. Yeah, we started and all that. And I heard the Holy Spirit say to me, it was a conversation he was having with me. It wasn't just I heard a voice. It was a conversation. The Holy Spirit said to me, "Joni, you're going to be the one to give." I heard my name. I knew then I was going to do it. All I had to do was succumb to that. And I did. I had no hesitation. There was no, let me think about it. There was none of that. I knew I was going to do it, and I was going to march forward because God had told me to do it. And I'm not going to be like Jonah. When he said to Jonah, go there, and he said no. Well, he got thrown into the belly of a whale. So I knew I was going to just succumb to what God was telling me to do. So that in itself I found to be quite amazing. So fast forward to March 15th. And again, I'm just abbreviating everything because so much has happened that God has done and shown me. So March 15th, both she and I are in the hospital having our surgery. And after my surgery, her surgeon came to see me at the hospital and said, "Joni, you gave your sister-in-law a great kidney." Apparently, when my surgeon took my kidney out, they found an extra vessel, a vessel they hadn't found in all the testing that they had done. And there were extensive testing. So she takes my kidney out. They find this extra vessel. Usually they can't use a third vessel. By the way, only 20% of people who donate a kidney, they find that extra vessel. They usually can't use it because it's only 1 millimeter wide and they can't open it to use it. Well, mine was 3 millimeters wide. And the first thing I thought of was God prepared that kidney even while I was being formed in my mother's womb. So they were able to use the kidney, they cleaned it, they were able to splice it in with the other vessel. And she ended up getting 25% more blood right off the bat. And her surgeon told me that kidney worked immediately. She never has to go through dialysis again. So her kidney is now functioning so well, she doesn't have to go through, like I said, any more dialysis. They took the port out. She's able to eat and drink without measuring her liquids. And it's just been an amazing journey. And this is just the tip of these little icebergs that I'm telling you about. So she's doing well. My life doesn't change at all. My life expectancy is still the same as what God had ordained it from the very beginning. And I'm just so thankful that God gave those words to my dad all those years ago. He was a great man of God. And he was obedient when God gave him those words to tell it to me so it can come back to me during this conversation. So I just want to thank God for that, and thank you, Pete, for all your support you gave me.
That is the quietest I've seen Pete ever since I've known him. Pete is the talker in the family. So, but that I wanted to connect you to that story, because lots of times in church we come on Sunday mornings and we don't really know what's going on in people's lives. But there's a lot of things going on in people's lives, and we need to always remember to be praying for one another, just as Joni was saying. She knows, she felt the blanket of prayer all around her. So I want you to connect to our ministries. I want you to connect to individuals. And I just want us to connect as friends together. You know, and coming out of COVID, it's one of those things, I believe we got in a habit of just being isolated. In church, we're not supposed to be isolated. We're supposed to be connected in Christ. I do want you to take note of several things in the bulletin coming up in May. And the purpose of these things is so that you might connect. We want you to connect. Notice there is going to be a Mother's Day tea next Saturday, right? And this is for all the ladies of the church. And if you're going to come and you haven't already notified, let the office know, or Becky know in particular, because they're finalizing food and that kind of stuff. But I want you to be aware of that. Also, I want you to be aware that the Sunday after next, it's the 15th, on Sunday evening at 6 o'clock, we're going to meet right out here in this parking area. And we're going to have Sundays. We're going to have ice cream sundae. You can, if you got a weird topping, you want to put, you know, some kind of Mexican hot sauce on top of your sundae, you bring it. We'll have some of the regular things. If you want something different, you're going to have to bring that. And we'll also have yard games like cornhole and yard, not yard darts, because that could be dangerous. That's not politically correct anymore. But, you know, some of these things, if you got a yard game you want to bring and share, you can go ahead and do that as well. Why do we do that? Because we need to be family. You're all families get together for reunions and picnics and that kind of stuff. Don't you think the church family ought to do that? And that's the reason. Now, you've got to decide if you're going to try to connect with your church family or if you're just going to stay isolated at home. That's your choice. But we're creating the opportunities for that. And then also, each year we have our Memorial Day picnic, and it will be coming up on May the 29th at the lake property. So start making plans for that. So I just want you to remember, this is Connect Sunday. We've got Connect Fellowships. We just want you to connect with each other. But when Joni was sharing that testimony, I was thinking in my mind, you know what? She voluntarily made a sacrifice. She had to go through a surgery in order to donate the kidney to her sister-in-law in order that her sister-in-law's life might be prolonged. But when we think about Jesus Christ, He was a life donator. He donated His entire life to die on the cross, not to be put to sleep so that He wouldn't feel the pain of the cross. In fact, He wouldn't even take any kind of sedative that might weaken His mental capabilities while He felt the torture of the cross. And when He donated His entire life on the cross, He wasn't doing it so that He might just extend our physical life. He was doing it so that He might offer us eternal life forever and ever. And when we come together in worship, we are worshiping the One who has made eternal life possible through His sacrifice, His donation of sorts. And as we get ready to begin today, I want us to commemorate what He did for us on the cross the way we are taught in Scripture to commemorate that, and that is through the Lord's Supper. So if you will, I'd like for you to take your little prepackaged elements there, bend that tab forward. Some people have said that they still haven't fully grasped these little packets. Be careful there. I'll give you time, so don't feel. In fact, right now I'm having difficulty. There, I finally caught mine. I think the glue on this set is much tighter than the other set. I always read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul's words concerning the Lord's Supper. The Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it. The breaking of the bread was the symbolism of his broken body that he was about to sacrifice or donate upon the cross. So, Father, as your son prayed to you, asking your blessing on the bread, symbolizing the sacrifice that he was about to make, right now as we begin this worship service, we want to thank you with all of our hearts that you loved us so much you sent your only begotten son to die for us. We take this bread today, remembering the sacrifice of Jesus, and we praise you that that is the way that we have been saved. So Jesus said, then take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then it says, in the same manner, which I assume then is prayer over the next element. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper. So, Father, as we listen to all of these cups being opened, we do so even just participating with the opening of the cup, looking at the contents of the cup, remembering the symbolism of the cup, that this juice, the wine, it represents the blood of your son. Not only was he beaten, but he was pierced. The slashes from the whip that ripped his skin, the nails that penetrated his hands and his feet, and the spear ultimately then that pierced his side. All of this, his blood flowed so that we might be saved. Today we thank you again, remembering through the cup, just as you've taught us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And if you remember, it says they sang a hymn and then they went on out to the Mount of Olives. I think we need to sing a few more than just one hymn today. How about that? You good with that? Brother Ben, why don't you come and introduce who's going to lead us in this worship of music today?
You turned it off.
Hello.
Randy Roper told us about this group, and I'm really excited to introduce them to you. I will say that at the end of the service, the deacons will be at the doors for accepting offering to help them in their ministry and what they do. I want to introduce someone to you first that's not going to be on the stage, that's responsible for this group. Kevin and Wendy Shaw, would you please stand? They are responsible for 10 times this group. 10 times. Now, three are not here, but two are not here. The other three are. Josh is back there with him, and it's good to have them. But I'm going to introduce them one at a time. And we're going to have the girls first, and I'm going to introduce Macy to you. Macy, if you'll come up, and then we'll clap for all of them. There's too many to start clapping. This is Macy. And then there's Ellie. Ellie's not going to sing? Fine. And then there's Amy. Watch out, boys. And then there's Lily. And then the guys, Justice. And here's Peter. And last but not least, here is Daniel. Now you can say hello to him. Daniel, don't drop that guitar. They came in last night. They came in last night with his guitar, and the top part of it was broken off. And thanks to Luke Pelly, he is playing Luke's guitar today. Before we begin to worship, I want us to pray. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for this family, what they've already meant to me. May we just forget about everything else now and worship you. To God be the glory. Great things he has done. And God's children said,
so glad to be here with you this morning. Give Ben a round of a hand for remembering all of our names. Who's ready to worship the Lord with us this morning? Awesome. Please stand with us as we sing Crown Him with Many Crowns.
All my life you have. with a melody you surround me with, a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer
you
We have been so looking forward to being here with you guys on this Sunday because this is our first performance, leading worship, doing music as a family for this new year. And so after Christmas tour, we took a little break of doing music, and we are all one family up here. So this is all siblings, all from the same mom and dad. And I'm going to quickly introduce everyone for you so that way you know who we are. And over here on the piano is Lily. Lily is the youngest girl in the family. And give her a hand on the piano, doing a great job over there. And over here on the drums, Peter, why don't you stand up? Peter, keeping it on the drum. Everyone give him a hand. He's doing such a great job. He's the loudest instrument, so we give him the hardest time. So he really appreciates your compliments for sure and applause. Over here on the bass is Amy, and Amy is 17. Everyone give her a hand. And over here is Justice. Justice is 21, and he's on the electric guitar singing, doing a whole bunch of stuff. And I am Macy. I am the oldest sibling here, third oldest out of the 10 siblings. And then over here on the stool is Daniel. Give him a hand. Daniel's been playing the guitar for about 6 months to a year, and this was going to be his first time playing the guitar while we were doing music, and he was so excited. And we pulled up yesterday, and we were here with Ben. We were getting all set up, and we pulled his guitar out of the case, and the whole neck had snapped. And I felt so bad for Daniel because I was like, I know he's been looking forward to this so much. And so Ben was able to make a few phone calls and get this guitar. Now, this is a lot bigger than Daniel's used to playing. I mean, I'm pretty sure it's the same height as him. And so he's up on the stool here this morning. Luke over here was so gracious to let Daniel play his guitar. So thank you so much, Luke. We really appreciate it, him to be able to play. We're so, so glad to be able to be here with you all this morning. We do music as a family, and we love it. And we're going to do a song for you now that isn't original song, and we wrote it this past summer. Just a quick story about us. If you're like, I have no idea who you guys are, I just found out today that you guys were going to be doing music. We are a family. We were born and raised California, and 3 years ago, God called us to Nashville. We've been doing music as a family for several years, and last summer was interesting because our rent was up on our house, and so we ended up moving out of that house. But how many of you guys are familiar with the whole housing situation craziness that's going on? A few hands. You will definitely relate to the story. We were without a house. Like, there was no house to move into. Unless we were wanting to pay like $1 million for like a shack. And we were not in the position to do that. So we were homeless. I mean, we were living out of the RV. So we weren't quite like stranded on the streets. But we were homeless, and a week turned into 2 weeks, to turn to 3 weeks, to 3 months, and we ended up spending the whole summer just living as a family out of the RV until God provided a house for us in the fall. But it was interesting because during this time, we had a lot of people praying for us. We were praying, of course, asking God to provide a house, and we were in the studio during this time recording this song about the faithfulness of God. Isn't that funny how sometimes God will give you a project to work on or a topic to speak about or to sing about, and it's something that you seem is contrary to your circumstances? How many of you have felt that when you are thinking back to the faithfulness of God, you're kind of like, this is interesting because I don't feel the faithfulness of God in my life? How many of you have felt that before? A lot of hands. And so you will probably relate to this. We were writing the song about the faithfulness of God, and we were kind of asking God, where are you in this situation? And looking back now, we can see that God's hand was just all throughout that story. And he was just writing a beautiful story about how he was providing, but he was really building our faith. And so as we sing this song about the faithfulness of God, and you are in a season right now where you feel like God's not providing, you're just kind of wondering where he's at, just be encouraged that he's building your faith like he was building our faith. And he is faithful because he promises to be so. Sweet, somehow I just believe that
your back on me.
And you'll always be faithful.
That we actually just found a couple like weeks ago, and we were like, this is an awesome song, we're gonna have to put it in this set. And so it's such a fun one to do, and it's just about how, like Mace was saying, where you're like needing, where is God, right? It's just about where, like, when you're going through the waters, God is always right there. Wherever you are, he will part the waters, he will be there with you during that moment. So let's do it.
On the water.
was such a fun one to do. I'm noticing that all these songs are about like God leading you through difficult situations and parting the waters and the faithfulness of God. But I know that if we were to take the time and just hear all of your stories this morning, you would all have a story of the faithfulness of God, just like Joni shared. I mean, that was an incredible testimony of just how God was working in her life just from the day that even while she was in the womb, just the day she was born. And so be encouraged in that this morning, that God is still writing your story.
I was going to say the same thing, that there's a common theme of faithfulness through our whole thing, which is awesome because it kind of reflects, you know, where we are at and where we've been, you know, this last year, writing and preparing all these songs. And, you know, there's nothing to sugarcoat about life. Life can get tough sometimes, even with a big family. You saw all these smiling faces up here. We all look alike, you know, but life's not picture perfect. You know, it's not always easy. You know, there's only one bathroom to get ready in this morning. But the good news is that through all of that, there's someone to always walk with you and that can walk you through and out of that fire. I remember how you told me that life may not be easy, and that everything that I need, you've already given me. I remember how you told me I can trust you completely. So why am I doubting when you've proved that you'd fight for me? And 'cause you've walked me through fire, from flames. If you're in this with me, I won't be afraid. When the smoke billows higher, oh, and higher, and it feels like I can barely breathe, I walk through these fires, 'cause you're walking with me. Oh, I'm changed by your mercy, I'm covered by your peace, living out the victory. Doesn't mean that I won't feel the heat, 'cause you walked me through fire. You're walking with me. Amen. This is Daniel, and you've seen him in the corner about all this morning. So Daniel, they need a, they kind of want to find out who you are.
Well, how are y'all doing out this morning? Yeah. Well, I'm Daniel, and I am 10 years old, and like me said, I just got started playing the guitar. And that definitely was devastating when I saw that little neck crack. Actually, earlier, like a couple weeks ago, I was, you know, playing it, and the strap on one of the ends of the guitars fell off. And it fell on the base of a mic stand, and it cracked. So that thing's just getting beat up. Anyways, yeah, that was definitely nice how I could play. Thanks, Luke, for letting me use your guitar. That was definitely great. Anyways, this next song I'm going to sing for you is called Ain't It Like Jesus.
Dan, way to go. You know, that's the fun part about being in a FIG family is that there's so many siblings, there's so much fun, and we are so thankful for our parents for starting us in music early. And the most common question we get asked is, how did you get started in music? And our parents started us off in violin at 4, and they were always wanting us to serve with music, so we went to nursing homes, and we sang for grandma and grandpa, and we sang for the neighbors, and we really sang wherever we could, and we're just so thankful that the Lord has brought us to Nashville. And like Justice said, it has not always been easy, and doing things together as a family is really fun, but sometimes the fact that we're working together is what can bring out those conflicts or those times of clashing. And so we're so thankful that the Lord has given us this opportunity to build stronger relationships. We're very thankful for that. And thank you, Ben, for introducing our parents. Our dad and mom, you saw them stand up, and there are 10 siblings total, and 6 of us are up here on stage, and we absolutely love doing what we get to do together, and we love just sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I know that there's some baptisms coming up this morning, which is just going to be incredible, but that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's just, whoever calls in the name of the Lord shall be saved. And when we, as sinners, ask Jesus to come into our lives and repent of our sins, he promises us the free gift of salvation and eternal life with him. We want to share that with you this morning, and we just want you to receive the message of the gospel and receive also the message of hope and forgiveness and the fact that he is with us always after that.
I will tremble at no other name. My heart surrender to no other name. I will bow at no other throne and rest my heart in no other home. Let these hands lift no other crown. Let these knees fall on no other ground. Lift these eyes from the gold that won't shine. You turn this life from water to wine, and I tremble. Tremble, Lord, in your presence, in your presence. You take my breath with every starry night. You show your power in downtown city light. You are higher than the highest of the hills and stronger than the walls we tried to build. You blind me with the beauty of your face and hold me close with your divine embrace. You speak to me with healing in your words, and you fix the things I didn't know that hurt. And I tremble, I tremble, Lord, in your presence, in your presence.
Had an amazing morning so far. Awesome. Love that.
Also, shout out to Amy on the saxophone. She's only been playing that for a couple months, so give her a round of applause for having the confidence to come out and play that.
Good job, Amy. Good job. We're going to do a song that we're going to close with an amazing hymn called Great Is Thy Faithfulness. How many of you just love that song? Awesome. We'll do it for you. We'll do it for you. You will love the song then. And we're going to do the hymn, Great Is Thy Faithfulness. And this whole song and the whole theme of just all the stories about the faithfulness of God. And it's just amazing how when Pastor Marty was talking about everything that's going on in Belize, when Joni was sharing her testimony, just about how God is just so faithful. And he is faithful to complete a good work in us, his children. and he's faithful in your lives in the ins and the outs and all of that. So just worship the Lord with this song and just praise him and thank him for being thankful and faithful to you.
Ever to win.
You may be seated. I'm on. Check. As we prepare for baptism, I want us to go to the Lord in prayer. And HL Knight, would you lead us in prayer? Just ask God's blessings on these two young ladies as they start their new life in Christ. Amen. Would you be so kind to give us an encore as they prepare to be baptized?
You know, this morning before we had these baptisms, I was thinking in my mind, we got a young group of siblings up here leading worship, and they're leading it in a young fashion as well. I was thinking about a lot of our older folks in the congregation, even back in the 60s and 50s, when Billy Graham was really coming to the fore. He was doing it through the youth movement, and they were reaching out. Billy Graham, that was his first target, was young people, and they were reaching out through younger music for that day, and they were successful. And some of you older folks might have been those younger folks that the Billy Graham of that time reached out. There was a youthful vibrance up here, and I absolutely loved it, because we've got a generation of young folks that we need to reach, and we're going to have to reach them with that kind of vibrancy that you saw on the platform this morning. But I was going to say to Daniel, is he in the room right now? There he is. Daniel, you think you've got to move when you're doing that little shoulder shake up there? You ought to see Brother Ben when he cuts a groove. He'd keep right up there with you, even though he's a few years older than you. But this morning, along with just the young folks who've led in worship, we have two young ladies who want to give testimony to their faith. This is Abby Nelson. My wife has some young girls who come over to our house on Tuesdays. They call it Taco Tuesdays. They do some Bible study and things like that. And what was it, 3 or 4 weeks ago? They were on our back deck, and I was in the kitchen. No, I wasn't. Usually I'm in the kitchen cleaning up all their leftovers by eating them, but they were out on the deck, and they were talking, and Becky was telling me that it just came up talking about being saved. And Abby and one of the other girls who's not with us, she was one of the foster children who had been in our church family that has moved to another town. But they both said, we've not given our life to Christ. And there on the deck, they both prayed and asked Jesus to forgive them and save them. And Abby's coming today to share with you that story. Now, Abby, have you asked Jesus to forgive you and save you and to become Lord of your life?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I was telling her and the next young lady that when they're being baptized, it's like a play or a drama. And when they're standing up in the water, it is the person who's being baptized saying, I believe Jesus died for me on the cross. And when the person is put under the water, it's saying, I believe Jesus was buried for 3 days as part of my salvation. And when we bring Abby up out of the water, it is saying, and I believe Jesus rose from the grave and is alive today, and it is the living Jesus who saves me. And I always explain that, especially to our young people, that they are giving testimony through a drama. Just like Joni gave testimony through her words, the Shaws have given testimony through their songs, Abby and Elaine are giving testimony through this drama called baptism. So let's turn around here. So Miss Abby, in obedience to the commands of our Lord and Savior, and upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This is Melaine Waters. Now, Melaine didn't get saved at our house. She has been coming to the house, but Melaine, the last Connect Sunday we had when Avi Snyder was here, you remember that? Jews for Jesus? And he was sharing. I asked at the end of the service, after he had shared the gospel, if anybody had received Christ here today. Melaine was sitting over here in this section, and I saw her little hand go up. And after service, I made sure I tracked her down. And she said she prayed and gave her life to Jesus on that Connect Sunday. And today she comes to let you know that through this drama we call baptism. So, Melaine, have you asked Jesus to forgive you and save you and become your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. So today, then, in baptism, we want to profess that. So
in obedience to the commands of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. It is wonderful to worship the Lord, to connect with the Lord, and connect with His people. And I hope that you've been able to do that. As we get ready to close, there's just two or three things I want you to be praying about. Number one, Charles Young passed away this past week. He has gone on, and as I talked to him in the hospital there in Oak Ridge, I said, look, if things go the course you're expecting them to go, in a very short time, you're going to be seeing Jesus face to face worshiping Him. You know what? We miss our brothers and sisters in Christ when they pass on, but they get to experience something that we've yet to experience. And we need to thank the Lord that even in death, there is victory in Christ Jesus. Tom Sperling had brain surgery this past week, and he's already back at home, and I saw him at his house, and he's just as chipper and upbeat as usual, having some blurry vision and things you continue to remember. Betty, as she's lost Charles, remember Tom as he is recovering from the surgeries. Just pray for one another. Love one another as we have been loved by the Lord Jesus, and we love Him back. So, Father, I thank You so much for this day. I pray that we as Your people will be able to not only connect internally, but we will be able to reach people externally. Share Jesus with them so that they can put their faith in Him and be saved just as we have. Help us not to keep this good news into ourselves. Help us to be excited about sharing it with the world. And Lord, whether we contribute to this through our monies, through our time, through our words, may You multiply in ways that we know we can't do by ourselves. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.